Hey Art Family, if you like this one, there's a full-length version on Patreon.
They are skillful.
Hello Art Family, and thanks to all the new subscribers. I recently did a video showing the difference between gouache and watercolor, and doing a watercolor scene in gouache. So I thought for this demo, I would take a scene I did in gouache about a year ago and do it with watercolor, but do it much, much larger. So this is an arches block. It's 16 by 20 cold pressed paper. I'm using a red Prismacolor pencil here, the Colorace kind. And I'm drawing here based on a kind of approximation of the halfway point of the page and the thirds of the page. And then I'm also looking for invisible lines where things line up. So the edge of that house is a little bit before the bus, different places, the angles of the roof and that sort of thing. Trying to find these invisible lines throughout the whole composition that I can sort of link things together. It also helps to hold my pencil up in front of my face and try to find the angles of things like the rooftops and carry that down over onto the page and sort of try to get a good idea. A lot of times I'll put the angle down and then I'll try to do that to see if I was close or if it needs to be nudged in any direction. Now I'm wetting the whole page. If we're condensing the values, this whole color wash is going to be my lightest value. Apart from a couple little highlights like the top of the bus that I want to preserve, this is going to be my lightest value. So I'm going to cover the whole page. I'm going to try to keep it fairly colorful, but my main concern is to just transition from cool to warm to cool to warm. Like in the sky, transitioning subtly from cool to warm. This will eventually be the kind of highlights on my clouds. And now I'm starting to work in the clouds. I'm doing this fairly arbitrarily in that I'm just putting in these big sort of random shapes. Ideally, I would have done this while the page was still wet on top, but it took me too long working my way down. Ideally, I would do it while it's still wet so that you'd have a nice soft edge, like I'm trying to do now with this rooftop, trying to keep a soft edge for things in the distance. The goal is to have everything out of the range of focus that I don't want to draw attention to have softer edges, which is where two colors meet one another. Because the page was kind of dry, what I ended up doing is I let the sky dry as it was and just dry with the sort of hard edges here and there in the clouds. And then at the end, after I'm done getting in my major shapes, I go back with some clean water and just lay down some glazes of clean water over top of everything that I don't want to have really hard edges. And that kind of works to sort of loosen and soften up the pigments and soften up some of those edges. Working on these big shapes, I started out using a squirrel brush and I've transitioned now to a synthetic squirrel brush. I'm using squirrel brushes because this is 16 by 20. It's much larger than I usually work. I usually work around 9 by 12. So I'm using a squirrel brush because it retains a lot of water so you can move a lot faster through big shapes, making big shapes of color. One of the keys to and difficult things to get used to when you're working much larger than smaller is just the amount of reloading you have to do. So you have to preset a lot more puddles or a lot more in your puddles of color that you're going to work in, because as you work across a large area, you have to reload constantly. If you run the brush ragged and then try to reload with water and then go back into an area that's fairly light in water, you risk getting blooms or an uneven distribution of water. So it's good to just reload constantly and quickly, and try to keep in mind how much water you're using in your mix. The cast shadow of the house on the other house, I used much less water in that area. I tried to keep that luminescent, adding some pinks and kind of purples to it, but I used much less water because I wanted that area to be darker. I would have had a cleaner looking picture had I done a lot of this stuff I'm doing now in the initial wash by controlling the amount of water I used when I was setting down those tones. A lot of the tones I'm putting down now are lighter values anyways, the lighter value of the house. Now it's not as light as the light values, so I needed to knock it down a little bit further, but I'm mostly trying to set myself up so that I can anchor this image down using darker value on top of these lighter values. When I start putting in the cast shadow and the shadows within the tree, it'll start to sort of anchor or frame this drawing. That was something that really attracted me to this drawing, or the scene, I should say, is that the bus itself is white, has a large white area, and I can create that using the negative drawing or negative painting of the shapes behind it because it has these strong dark area behind the bus. I'm trying to bear in mind the most simple shape of the forms that I'm looking at. So in my mind, I'm trying to forget the fact that this is a bus and just think of it as a kind of Twinkie or a brick. And these buildings are just like tissue boxes or shoe boxes. And with that, these very simple shapes have different planes, and I try to consider how light affects those planes. So what I'm doing now is I'm kind of popping in these yellow ochre or raw sienna, these warm notes of color that are just delineating those downward facing planes. So the planes that face the ground, we're going to have light that bounces off the concrete or the lower rooftops and bounces up into those lower facing planes, creating a kind of luminescent glow. So I'm going through and setting myself up for that. I'm also trying to delineate the form on the bus now, which I'm going to come back with a cool color. Because the bus is white on top, it's going to catch a lot of that fill light from the sky, much like this shadow now. I'm using ultramarine and burnt sienna with a little bit of raw sienna towards the lower end where light is kind of popping into the cast shadow, but I'm using a lot of cools in those areas because I'm trying to remember the fact that I've got a warm, hot warm light from the sun and then cool fill light from the sky, the blue sky. So it's called a fill light because it's not strong enough to really light up a scene. It's only really strong enough to fill an area that is in shadow. So it's filling up those shadows with cool light, and I'm adding some variation there because light and color is constantly bouncing around. So you constantly get a kind of variable of warm to cool. So I'm adding burnt sienna into the mix. So I have ultramarine and burnt sienna. And I really liked the way that cool blue color around those areas, those big areas of cool blue, are kind of offset by this bright orange bus. I'm starting to delineate the separation of form on the bus, and I'm starting to anchor the image down by putting in these strong cast shadows. Now that I have these areas where I like them, I'm going to start working in this tree. I'm using the side of the brush, and I'm using a large perla brush, which is a really nice brush from Escoda. This particular one is, I think, a size 18 or maybe a 20. It's very thick at the base, so it retains a lot of water. It's a synthetic brush, and the tip is tapered to a very sharp point. So you can do both large areas and small detail, or a combination of the two if you're having to work around odd shapes in a sketch. I'm trying to not focus on what I'm sketching when I work out this bus and just think of the simple shapes, and think even more simply when I'm working on the SUV in front of the bus, because I don't want it to take away from the object of interest in the sketch, which is the VW bus. So I'm just closing one eye and squinting at this photograph and just asking myself, and it helps here because it's black and white, what's the most simple shapes I'm seeing? So I have this kind of rectangle that's tapered, and then I've got the wheel, and then a couple dots here and there, and then I'm going to let the white kind of communicate the rest of that form. But I'm not trying to get into drawing the bumper or drawing the doors or the curves of the back of that SUV. And it's the same for doing the bus here. I'm trying to not focus on what exactly it is I'm sketching and just what are these basic shapes. How can I link these shapes together? These shapes are all sort of linked together, the tire and the kind of hub. And then they're linked through the bottom as well, through this longer cast shadow that's going to be cool as it goes out blue and transition to a warm burnt sienna, burnt umber as it gets under the bus, where I'm trying to capture that light kind of bouncing around on the inside. For the interior of the windows, I'm using more burnt umber in the mix, so an ultramarine and burnt umber, leaning more heavily on the burnt umber to have a warm color, because I want to make sure you get the feeling that light is entering this object, that these are windows, so light enters this object and kind of bounces all around, creates a sort of glow. It's tempting to go cool blue with those because people tend to think that light from the sky is reflected in the windows, and sometimes it catches the right angle, but more often than not, when you're looking through a window, the value is going to be a dark, warm color. So now I've got my major shapes in order, and I'm trying to just fine-tune the value at this point. Ideally, I wouldn't have to do this. You know, the best case scenario is that you have minimal layers when you're doing watercolor. But I have some things that I need to adjust, and I look and compare area to area, this area to that area, and I look at the photograph in this case, and I just compare the values. Are things lighter or darker, and how can I adjust them to read a little more clearly? I'm continuing to just fine-tune and adjust these values to try to get them closer, and then what I'm going to do is, once it dries, I'm going to come back with a clean wash of clean water and just knock back the edges. After that, I'm going to take some time to get rid of the reference photo and put it away and stop looking at it. I'm going to peel off the tape so I get a better idea of what the finished image is going to be, and then sort of go on my own at this point and just look at this and ask myself, how can I improve this? What would make this a better painting so it's not just a document of a photograph or something I saw? What I felt was lacking was that there's this big open space that I felt like sort of caused a jumble of information and was not as interesting or competed with interest, I should say, and so I wanted to make it less interesting and knock this area back by pretending there's a large tree or some shapes on the right that are casting a large shadow, maybe even touching the bus. That gives the viewer a feeling that this scene is bigger than this painting, that there's shapes outside of this that are going on as well. So that's going to be it for this demo. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. In the meantime, happy sketching.